Let's pray. Our loving God, what a joy and a privilege it is to come before your throne today, to open your holy book and hear your voice speaking to us through the ministration of the Holy Spirit. We ask that as we study about the patience of the saints, that you will teach us what we need to learn, for we know that soon in this world, unbelievable events are going to take place, and we need that unshakable and unbreakable faith in order to go through this period successfully. So we ask, Lord, for divine guidance in our study, and we thank you for hearing our prayer, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. In Revelation chapter 15, in verses 2 and 3, we find the description of an end-time group of saints who have gained the victory over the beast, over his image, over his mark, and over the number of his name. I'd like to read those verses as we begin our study today. Revelation 15, verses 2 and 3. And I saw something like a sea of glass mingled with fire, and those who have the victory over the beast, over his image, and over his mark, and over the number of his name, standing on the sea of glass, having harps of God. At this point, this group is seen as having gained the victory over the beast, his image, his mark, and the number of his name. Of course, the question begs to be asked, how did this group of saints, the living saints when Jesus comes, how did they gain the victory over the beast and over his image and over his mark and the number of his name? How did they face this incredible crisis upon planet Earth? The answer is that they exercised what the Bible calls the patience of the saints. Now that expression, patience of the saints, appears in two very important places in the book of Revelation. The first place is in Revelation 13 and verse 10, if you go with me there. Revelation 13 and verse 10. And by the way, this verse comes immediately before the passage that speaks about the final trial over the beast, his image, his mark, and the number of his name. In other words, this verse introduces the final crisis. And I want you to notice what it says. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. And then, beginning in verse 11, you have a beast that rises from the earth. It has two horns like a lamb, but it speaks like a dragon, and it becomes a persecuting power. So notice that the patience of the saints is spoken of as a group who have this quality immediately before the end time crisis over the beast, his image, and his mark. The second place in the book of Revelation where this expression, the patience of the saints, is found is in Revelation 14 and verse 12. Go with me to Revelation 14 and verse 12. By the way, this is the conclusion of the third angel's message. If you go to the previous verses, verses 9 through 11, you'll notice it talks there about worshiping the beast, his image, receiving his mark, and the number of his name. And immediately after the third angel's message, we find these words. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. So you'll notice that in Revelation 13, verse 10, the expression patience of the saints appears immediately before the end time crisis is described. Those who go through this period must have the patience of the saints. Revelation 14, 12, immediately after speaking about the beast and his image and his mark, it says that there's a group that needs to have the patience of the saints. So obviously the patience of the saints refers to an end time group who has this specific quality. Now we need to define some terms. First of all, we need to define the word patience. And then, of course, we're going to see who the saints are. The word patience in the New Testament is the Greek word hupomone. There are two words in the New Testament, two primary words that express patience. One is translated in the King James, long-suffering. That's the word makrothumia. That means to suffer long. That's not the word that is used here in these two passages. The word that is used is hupomone. And let me tell you what that word means. It means to hang in there, no matter what the cost, to persevere, to endure, to be steadfast, to be independent, unyielding, and defiant in the face of aggressive misfortune. In other words, this word is not simply sitting down and saying, okay, I'll be patient. No, this is an active patience. This is an endurance or a perseverance. By the way, it's the same word that is used in Matthew 24, where Jesus says, he who endures until the end will be saved. So this is an active patience. It's a patience of people who are unyielding, unbreaking in their faith and in their trust in God. Now the question is, who are the saints? Because this is the patience of the saints. Who are the saints? Well, you know, depending on which group of Christians you're talking to, they would understand the word saints in a different way. You know, for some people, the saints are, like all of the saints that are mentioned in California. Seems like there's a saint for every city in California. So they think that these saints are these heroes, these wonderful Christians throughout the period of Christian history. But in the Bible, the saints represent primarily, specifically in Daniel and Revelation, those who are persecuted by the little horn, by the beast, and by the harlot of Revelation 17. In other words, the saints are not just any group. They are the ones who were persecuted by these end-time powers. I want to read several statements from Scripture so that you can see this. Notice Daniel chapter 7, verses 21 and 22. We're defining the saints. The saints are those who suffered persecution under the beast, the little horn, and who will suffer persecution under the harlot, this apostate church. It says there in Daniel 7, verse 21, I was watching, and the same horn was making war against whom? Against the saints, and prevailing against them. So the saints are God's persecuted people. Notice Revelation 13 and verse 7. Here it speaks about the beast, which is the same as the little horn. This is the way it reads. It was granted to him, that is to the beast, to make war with whom? With the saints, and to overcome them. So once again, the saints are those who are persecuted, those who are persecuted by the little horn or by the beast. Notice Revelation chapter 17 and verse 6. Revelation 17 and verse 6. It says, I saw the woman, this is a harlot woman, so it's a fallen church. I saw the woman drunk with the blood of whom? Of the saints, there it is again, and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I marveled with great amazement. So my question is this. When it speaks in Revelation about the patience of the saints, is this referring to a group of people who need to exercise patience because they are being persecuted? Yes. Within the context of prophecy, this is a persecuted group. Now, we know that in Scripture, the saints and the woman represent the same thing. Let me just mention how we determine that. We just read in Daniel 7 that the little horn persecutes the saints. We read that the beast of Revelation 13 also persecutes the saints. And how long does the little horn, how long does the beast, how long do they persecute the saints? Well, time, times, and the dividing of time. And in Revelation chapter 13, it's for a period of 1,260 days or a period of 42 months. Now, the little horn, in other words, and the beast persecute the saints for 1,260 years. But it's interesting to notice that in Revelation chapter 12, it says that the dragon persecutes the woman for 1,260 days. So let me ask you, are the saints and the woman the same thing? Absolutely. Because the little horn and the beast persecute the saints, whereas we're told also in Revelation 12 that the dragon persecutes the woman. So the saints are the woman. And the woman represents what? The woman represents specifically the church. So are you understanding what we're talking about when we deal with the word patience? It's dealing with God's people who are being persecuted by the beast and by the harlot and by the little horn, and they have to exercise incredible perseverance, incredible, unshakable, and unbreakable faith in order to stand firm and not worship the beast or receive his mark or the number of his name. Now, I believe that Jesus told a parable that illustrates what is meant by the expression, the patience of the saints. This parable is found in the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 18 and verses 1 through 8. And I'm going to just read this parable, and I want you to listen carefully because we're going to then study each verse individually. Luke chapter 18, verses 1 through 8. Here Jesus is describing this period when God's people, the saints, are going to have to exercise this patience of the saints, this unshakable, unbreakable, unyielding faith and trust in the face of horrendous persecution. It says there, "Then he spoke a parable to them, that men always ought to pray and not lose heart, saying, there was in a certain city, a judge, who did not fear God nor regard man. Now there was a widow in that city, and she came to him saying, get justice for me from my adversary. And he would not for a while. But afterward he said within himself, though I do not fear God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. Then the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge said. And shall God not avenge his own elect, who cry out day and night to him, though he bears long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth?" So this is the parable that I believe is describing the phrase, the patience of the saints. Now we're going to take a look at this parable, and we're going to study it verse by verse to see how it applies, especially to the end time. Let's begin at verse 1. "Then he spoke a parable to them, that men always ought to pray." Two lessons from this parable. Men always ought to pray and not what? And not lose heart. In other words, they should always pray and they should never give up in their prayer experience in coming to God. And then I want you to notice verse 2. Here's the parable. "Saying, there was in a certain city a judge who did not fear God nor regard man." Now the question is, what does the judge in this parable represent? Well, the fact is, folks, that the judge represents God. And you say, now wait a minute, Pastor Bohr. It says that this judge did not fear God or regard man. How can he represent God? The way in which this judge represents God is a comparison by way of contrast. In other words, they're not being compared as being equal. They're being compared by contrast. And we'll see this as we study along. We're going to notice in the parable that this widow comes to the judge, and she keeps on coming and coming, and the judge, he delays giving her justice, and finally says, to get her off my back, I'm going to give her what she's asking for. And then, of course, we're going to notice in the parable that the lesson is, you know, if this judge actually answers the pleas of the widow in order to get her off his back, how much more will God answer our pleas, not to get us off his back, but because he loves us? In other words, it's a comparison by way of contrast. They're not equal. They're not the same. God is in some senses the same as the judge, but in the sense of the reason why he answers, God is different. And so there's a comparison by way of contrast. Now notice Luke chapter 18 and verse 3. So the judge represents God. Now let's notice the widow. It says, now there was a widow in that city. Now the question is, what does the widow represent? The judge is God. What does the widow represent? Well, what does a woman symbolize in Bible prophecy? A woman represents the church. That's right. But is this a woman under ordinary circumstances? No. She's not a common, ordinary married woman. This woman is a what? She's a widow woman. In other words, she is totally destitute of any earthly support. She has lost everything she has, we're going to notice as we study along. In other words, this is a woman, this is the church, under extraordinary circumstances. Now, in the book of Revelation, the woman is used as a symbol of the church. And the woman is persecuted by the dragon. In other words, the woman is left destitute. She has to flee. She can't take anything with her. This is the period that is being described in this parable. It is a woman. It represents the church, but it's not the common ordinary church. It's the church that has lost everything that it has, all earthly support. In other words, this woman has been cleaned out by her adversary. And her only hope is found in the intervention of the judge in her behalf. Now, according to the parable, who does the widow represent? Well, if you read the parable, it says, will God not avenge his elect? As this judge avenged the widow, so God will avenge his elect. So what does the widow represent? She represents the elect of God. Another way of looking at it is she represents the saints of God. Now, according to most scholars who have studied this parable, they've concluded that probably this woman's husband had a debt with a creditor, and he died, and he didn't pay his debt. And so the creditor was actually taking everything away from this widow to pay for her husband's debt. In other words, this woman was totally dispossessed. She had no children. She had no home. She had no money. She had no friends. She was all alone, and she was forsaken of everyone. She had no human support because her adversary had cleaned her out totally and completely. Now let's go to chapter 18 and verse 3, the last half of the verse. It says there, and she came to him saying, get justice for me from my adversary. Now, that verb came is not real well translated there. It's actually a continuous tense. It's a continual tense. It means that she kept coming. She continually came. In other words, she didn't just come once and leave it at that. She kept on coming and coming and coming. You say, how do we know that? Well, first of all, the tense of the Greek verb is a continual tense. But also, if you notice verse 5, it says a little bit later in verse 5 that the judge says, I will avenge her, yes, lest by her continual coming she weary me. So you notice that this woman didn't only come once or twice and say, ah, what's the use? I give up. This judge is never going to do justice. No, she kept on coming and coming and coming, even though she was a woman that was totally destitute. I want you to notice something very interesting about this woman. This woman, which represents the church, totally destitute of human support, had a faith which was independent, unyielding, and defiant in the face of aggressive misfortune. But in the story, we also have an adversary. The Greek word is antidikon. The question is, who is this adversary? What is represented by the adversary in the parable that totally cleaned her out, that took everything, and left her without any human support? Who is this adversary? Well, 1 Peter 5, verse 8 uses the same word to describe Satan. Notice what it says in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8. Be sober. Be vigilant. Because your adversary, the antidikon, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may what? seeking whom he may devour. So who is the adversary that took everything from the widow? The adversary represents the devil. The adversary represents Satan. Now the question is, did this judge answer the widow's pleas immediately? No. Did she give up? No. What kind of patience did she have? She just sit down, she says, I'll wait for the judge to do it. No. She had a persevering faith, a persevering patience, an active patience, if you please. She says, I'm going to continue coming to him until I get justice, and I'm not going to give up. But there's a delay in the parable. Notice Luke chapter 18, verses 4 and 5. The judge does not answer her pleas immediately. It says, and he would not for a while. Is there a delay in the woman's pleas? Absolutely. But afterward, he said within himself, though I do not fear God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she what? She weary me. Did he give her justice for the right reason? No. He actually decided that he would avenge her to get her off his back. Is that the way that God listens to our pleas? He says, I'm just sick and tired of them coming and presenting their pleas before me, so I'm just going to give them what they ask so that I can get some sleep. That's not the way God is. You see, God is being compared with a judge by way of contrast. There is a delay in both cases. But when finally the judge answers, he answers for the wrong reason. When God answers, he answers for the right reason. Now let's go to Luke chapter 18 and verse 7. Here comes now the main lesson that Jesus wants to teach in this parable. It says there in chapter 18, verse 7, and shall God not avenge his own elect? So who does the widow represent? The elect. Who does the judge represent? God. And shall God not avenge his own elect who cry out, what? Day and night to him. Do they continue coming? Is this a patient endurance? Is this a perseverance that doesn't give up, even in the worst case scenario? Absolutely. But does God answer their pleas immediately? No, because it says, and shall not God avenge his own elect who cry out day and night to him, though he what? Though he bears long with them. Now, there are different versions of the Bible, of course, and it's interesting to notice how some of these versions translate this expression, though he bears long with them. The New International Version has this translation, will he keep putting them off? Does that mean that he did put them off for a while? Absolutely. Will he keep putting them off? The Jerusalem Bible has it this way, even when he delays to help them, so there is a delay. Or the Weymouth translation says, although he delays vengeance on their behalf. So is it clear that God is going to delay answering the pleas of his people in this period of human history? Absolutely. I want you to notice Luke 18 and verses 6 through 8. We already read verses 6 and 7, but I want us to notice the flow now. Luke 18, verses 6 through 8. Then the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge said. And shall God, who is the judge, by the way, not avenge over whom? The adversary, right? Shall God not avenge his own elect, that's the widow, who cry out day and night to him, though he bears long, there you have the delay, though he bears long with them. And then comes the answer. I tell you that he will what? Avenge them speedily. So even though there's a delay, is God going to intervene and avenge his elect over the adversary? And he's going to do it speedily. The Bible says yes. And then notice how the passage ends. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith in the earth? What is Jesus saying? He's saying, nevertheless, when I come, am I going to find this kind of faith that this widow had on the earth? And the parable ends. Now the question is, when does this parable especially apply in human history? Well, we need to look at the context. And I'm just going to not read the verses because there's too many of them. But if you look at the verses that come immediately before the parable, which would be Luke chapter 17 and verses 26 to 37, all of those verses are talking about the second coming of Jesus. And if you read the last verse that we just read from the parable, it says, "Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith in the earth?" The parable concludes by reference to the second coming. So the question is, when does this parable especially apply to? There's no doubt that it applies especially to the time of the second coming of Christ, because the passage that comes before the parable is talking of the second coming. The parable ends by asking the question, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on the earth? And so we know that this parable in between the two passages that talk about the second coming is referring to the crisis that will take place at the end of time. Now let's review the symbols. The judge represents God. The adversary represents Satan. The widow symbolizes the church. What kind of church? Just the church in times of peace like today, where everybody has plenty? Absolutely not. It's the church in dire straits. The church of the end time, the church of the tribulation, we're going to notice. And yet we notice that there's a delay. But after the delay, what does God do? God answers the pleas of his people. Now the question is, what is this parable really referring to in terms of time? Folks, I have no doubts whatsoever that Jesus is here speaking about the terrible time of tribulation that is going to fall upon this earth. It's going to be a time of trouble such as never has been seen in the history of the world. And only those who have the patience of the saints will stand before the beast and his image and will refuse the mark even on pain of death. They will not be immediately delivered. There will be a delay. They will have to go through this time of trouble, lose everything that they have, and yet they will not cease to come to God in prayer and to plead for his blessing and to plead for his protection and to plead for his presence with them. By the way, most Christians are expecting a pre-tribulation rapture. Are you going to need a special kind of patience and faith to get through this period? We noticed immediately before Revelation, or after Revelation 13, verse 10, you have the beast, his image, and his mark. Immediately after the third angel's message, you have what? A reference to those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus, and those who have the patience of the saints. And so it's speaking about the severe crisis that is going to come upon the world. And the patience of the saints will be needed by God's people. But if you believe that you're going to go to heaven before the tribulation, why would you prepare for it? See, the devil is shrewd. He knows that the church is going to be here during the tribulation. He knows that we're going to need an unshakable and unbreakable faith. He knows that we're going to need the patience of the saints to get through this period, to reject the beast and his image and the mark. And so he teaches Christians, says, don't worry about that. That's for the Jews after the church is in heaven. And when they find themselves in the time of trouble, they will be totally unprepared for the crisis that is taking place upon the world. By the way, that word elect that is used in the parable, I want you to notice Matthew 24 and verses 22 and 24, how that word elect is used in the context of the time of trouble and the final tribulation. Matthew 24, verse 22. It says, and except those days, this is the tribulation according to the context, should be what? Shortened. There should be no flesh be saved. But for whose sake? Ah, there's the key word in the parable. But for the elect's sake, those days shall be what? Shortened. Are God's people going to go through the tribulation? Yes, is there going to be a delay? There most certainly will be a delay. But is God going to intervene to answer their pleas? Absolutely. Now notice verse 24. For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive whom? The very elect. There's the word again. So when does this parable especially apply to? It applies to the period of tribulation through which the elect will go, according to Jesus in Matthew chapter 24. You see, folks, the widow represents the final generation of living saints that will dwell upon this earth. The book of Revelation calls them the 144,000. We have a complete lecture coming up on the 144,000. These people follow the Lamb wherever He goes. These people reject the beast. They reject His image. They reject the mark. They reject the number of His name. They plead day and night for deliverance from their enemies, from the adversary. They don't give up. They have unflinching perseverance to face this end time crisis. Well, let me ask you, who is the adversary during this period? The adversary, folks, is what? Is the devil. Is the devil going to take away from the church everything that the church has in terms of earthly support? Absolutely. The church, those who are faithful in the church, will be left totally destitute. And who will strip them of everything that they have? The devil will strip them of everything that they have, and they will have absolutely no earthly support. And as the parable says, they will cry out day and night for deliverance over their adversary who has taken everything that they have. By the way, the expression cry out, crying out day and night, that's used in the parable, is the same word that is used to describe Jesus on the cross, where He cries out with an intense agony to His Father, my God, why have You what? Why have You forsaken Me? Was there a delay in the case of Jesus Christ, the Father answering the pleas of His Son? Absolutely. He said, Father, let this cup pass from Me, if it's possible. Nevertheless, not My will be done, but Yours. Did God deliver Him out of the crisis? Did God remove Him from the trying circumstances that He was in? No. He continued going through this crisis, and He cried out to His Father. Apparently, His Father didn't listen, but eventually He was avenged over His enemy when He resurrected on resurrection morning. Now, is it just possible that God's people are going to go through a similar experience to the one that Jesus went through in Gethsemane? Absolutely. Through the one that Jesus went through on Calvary, that they will feel forsaken by God, that they will feel that the agony is too great to resist, and yet they will not let go of the hand of God. Is that just possible? Not only is it possible, but that's exactly what's going to happen. Do you know Isaiah 54, verses 7 and 8 describe this terrible period of human history when God's people will have to stand before the beast, His image, His mark, and the number of His name, totally destitute of any earthly support, nobody to be with them. They will cry out, my God, why hast Thou forsaken Me? And yet they will remain firm in their faith with God. Notice Isaiah 54, verses 7 and 8, where this period is being described by God. He says, for a mere moment, I have forsaken you. How long did God forsake? For a mere moment, I have forsaken you. But with great mercies, I will gather you. With a little wrath, I hid My face from you for what? For a moment. But with everlasting kindness, I will have mercy on you, says the Lord your Redeemer. So this period is going to be a relatively short period, a mere moment, the Bible says, and yet it will be a period of severe anguish, and God's people will continue coming and coming and coming. They will not let loose of the hand of God. Let me ask you, when is it that we have to learn to trust God in this way? If we don't learn now, we're never going to exercise that kind of patience in the future, that kind of endurance, unyielding faith in the case of the worst circumstances in the history of the world where we have no earthly support. Now, do you know that there are some stories in the Bible that illustrate this period? You remember the experience of Jacob, right? It's told in Genesis chapter 32. The Bible tells us there that he was returning home after 20 years in the house of Laban. And as he's nearing the promised land, he hears that his brother Esau is coming with 400 armed men, and they have evil intentions of destroying Jacob and his family. The Bible describes Jacob and his family as being totally defenseless. They have absolutely no way of protecting themselves against an irate brother. And so the Bible tells us that Jacob feared that he and his family would perish. And so he goes off to the other side of the river and he starts pouring his heart out in prayer to God. And while Jacob is praying, suddenly someone comes and grabs him. And Jacob, at first at least, he thinks that this is an enemy. It might even be his brother. And so he starts fighting and he starts struggling with this being. And they struggle all night. And finally the Bible says that when the sun was starting to come up, Jacob realized that he was struggling all night with the angel of the Lord, who is none other than Jesus Christ in the Old Testament. And so the angel of the Lord said to Jacob, "Let me go, for the sun is rising." And Jacob grabbed onto him and he said, "I will not let you go until you bless me." And the angel once again said, "Let me go, for the sun is coming up." And Jacob says, "No way, I will not let you go unless you first bless me." Let me ask you, did Jacob exercise the patience of the saints? Did he have that kind of persevering faith that kept on coming and coming to God? He most certainly did. And then, of course, the Bible tells us that Jesus, the angel of the Lord, blessed him there and changed his what? Changed his name. In fact, let's read this passage. It's found in Genesis 32 and verses 24 to 31. By the way, do you know what the end time of trouble is going to be called? It's the time of whose trouble? Oh, why do you suppose it's called the time of Jacob's trouble? Because it's going to be similar to the experience of whom? Of Jacob. And he refused to let go of God's hand. God's people will refuse to let go of God's hand until they have the certainty of God's blessing. It says there in Genesis 32, 24, "Then Jacob was left alone." Notice that he's there to anguish by himself. "And a man wrestled with him until the breaking of day. Now when he saw that he did not prevail against him, he touched the socket of his hip." Now did you notice that the angel did not prevail with Jacob? So what does the angel do? He touches the socket of his hip. "And the socket of Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, 'Let me go, for the day breaks.' But he said, 'I will not let you go unless you bless him, bless me.' So he said to him, 'What is your name?' He said, 'Jacob.' And he said, 'Your name shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed.'" Another way of translating is, "You have overcome." "Then Jacob asked, saying, 'Tell me your name, I pray.' And he said, 'Why is it that you ask about my name?' And he blessed him there. So Jacob called the name of the place." Now notice who he was wrestling with. He called the name of the place Peniel, "For I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved." Who was Jacob struggling with? He was struggling with God. Are God's people who go through the time of trouble going to be struggling with God in the midst of the worst suffering in human history, having lost everything, like the widow, destitute of human support? Absolutely. By the way, this period is described in Daniel 12 and verse 1, where it says, "At that time Michael shall stand up." Michael's a symbol of Christ. "Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people. And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that time. And at that time, your people shall be" what? "Your people shall be delivered, everyone who is found written in the book." Are God's people going to go through the tribulation? They most certainly are. It says that there will be a time of trouble such as there was never in the history of the world since there was a nation. But then it says, at that time, in the time of trouble, God will deliver his people. And so the experience of Jacob foreshadows the experience of God's people in the end time. As Jacob refused to let go of the hand of God, so God's people will refuse to let go of God's hand until he answers their pleas over their adversary. There's another Bible story, Old Testament story, that illustrates this period. It's the story of Job. Now let me ask you, if we apply the symbols of the parable, who would the widow represent in the story of Job? Of course, that would represent whom? Job. Did Job lose everything? Yes? Friends? The support of his wife? Health? Possessions? He lost everything, right? He was totally destitute, like this widow. Did he have an adversary? Who was the one who took everything? Who was it? The devil was the adversary. Took everything from him. Did Job cry out day and night for justice over his adversary? He most certainly did. And God answered immediately. The first time that he prayed, God answered and gave him everything back. No. Did Job keep on coming and coming and coming and not give up? He most certainly did. And what did God do eventually? The Bible says that God eventually avenged him over his adversary. You know, the faith of Job is illustrated in his expression that's found in Job 13, verse 15, where he says, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. In other words, he has this faith of the widow. He has absolutely nothing to lean on. His adversary has taken everything from him. He cries out day and night for deliverance from his adversary. God delays, but he doesn't give up. And eventually God, at the end of the story, gives Job what he lost plus another amount equal to it. He gave him twice as much. In other words, he answered the pleas of his servant. Are God's people going to receive far more than they had on this earth after the period of tribulation? They most certainly are. Because the things in this world really don't count. They don't matter. Because everything is going to burn up, folks. It's only our faith and trust in God that is going to carry us through the period of the tribulation that the Bible speaks of. You know, there's another story in the Old Testament that illustrates this same time, this same period. See, we have several. We have the story of Jacob, we have the story of Job, and we also have the story of the three young men in the fiery furnace. Who would the widow represent in that story? The three young men, right? Who would the adversary be? Well, behind the scenes, it would be the devil, but who specifically, historically? It would be Nebuchadnezzar, right? Were these three young men of prayer? Did they have that persevering, unshakable, and unbreakable faith in the face of death? They most certainly did. And when they come before King Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuchadnezzar says, "Don't you know that we can kill you?" They say, "Yeah, we know you can. But the God whom we serve will deliver us. And from your hand he will deliver us. But if he doesn't, nevertheless, we still serve him. Whether we live or whether we die, our mind is made up." Is this the kind of patience of the saints that this parable is talking about? Most certainly, yes. Now, did God answer the pleas of the three young men immediately? Could God have delivered them before they were thrown into the fire? Could God have given Nebuchadnezzar a heart attack? He most certainly could have. He could have made it much easier for them not to go through the furnace. And yet the Bible says that even though they had a close relationship with God and their minds were made up that they were going to be faithful to God no matter what, they had to go through the furnace of fire. Were their pleas finally answered by God? They most certainly were answered and they were rewarded by God. We have New Testament examples of this period of human history. You remember this woman from Canaan. She wasn't a Jew. And she had a daughter who was severely ill. And so she's following Jesus and she says, "Jesus, please heal my daughter." And you know what Jesus does first? He continues walking and acts like he's not hearing anything. But she continues pursuing. She says, "Please hear me. My daughter is sick. Please heal my daughter." And then she hears the disciples say, "Lord, this is embarrassing. Send her away." I don't know about you. I would have thought about twice about leaving at that point. But she didn't. She kept on coming. And then Jesus says out loud, "I'm not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." I'm out of there by then. Jesus is saying, "I wasn't sent to save Canaanites like you. I was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she doesn't give up. She continues coming to Jesus. And she says, "Lord, please save my daughter." And then Jesus caps it all off by saying, "It's not good to take the bread of the children of the kingdom and give it to the dogs." It appears like Jesus had called her a dog. I'm definitely out of there by then. But this woman had the type of faith that is described in this parable. She knew that Jesus wasn't that way. Her answer was delayed, but she was not about to give up. And was her faith rewarded because she persevered? Absolutely. Of course, the greatest example, folks, of this period is the experience of Jesus. When Jesus went through the experience in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he pleaded with his Father, "If it be possible to take away the cup, please take it away." Was everything taken away from Jesus? What did he lose everything? He lost his friends. He lost even the clothing that he had on, because he hung between heaven and earth naked on the cross. He had no earthly support. His feet were not even on the earth. And when he was on the cross, he cried out to his Father, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" He pleaded for the Father to deliver him. Did the Father immediately deliver him? No, because the Bible says that he died. There was a delay. But was his faith eventually rewarded over the enemy? Absolutely. When Jesus came forth from the tomb and he said, "I am the resurrection and the life," his faith and his trust in his Father and his continuous coming to his Father was rewarded. I'd like to read from Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 7, Hebrews chapter 5, verse 7, where this suffering of Jesus is described. It says there this, "Who, in the days of his flesh," that means while he was on this earth, "when he had offered up," notice, "prayers and supplications with vehement cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death." Was he saved from death at that moment? Was he saved from dying? No. He was saved from death when he resurrected. But he was allowed to go through the experience of death. He was not delivered from death when he actually died on what is called Good Friday. And so it says, "with vehement cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death and was heard because of his godly fear." Now, why did God allow Jesus to go through this? Notice verse 8. "Though he was a son," and it should not be a son, "though he was son," a special son, it says, "yet he learned" what? "He learned obedience by the things which he suffered." Is the delay during the time of trouble a blessing or a curse? It must be a blessing, because these are God's people. They're faithful. They're sealed. God is not going to curse them, but God knows that the best answer to their prayers is to delay the answer so that they learn to totally trust in him. Ellen White says in The Great Controversy that all earthliness must be consumed Notice not worldliness. She doesn't say all worldliness must be consumed. She says all earthliness. In other words, everything that links them or connects them to planet Earth must be consumed. In other words, their hearts must be totally and completely in heaven. You know what Job understood very well? The reason for his suffering. Notice what he says in Job 23 and verse 10. He says, when God has tried me, I shall come forth as what? As gold. So going through the fire is a refining process. Notice what we find in Isaiah 48 and verse 10. God says, behold, I have refined you, but not as silver. I have tested you in the furnace of what? In the furnace of affliction. I'd like to read a statement that we find in a wonderful book where you have a commentary on the parables. This is Christ's Object Lessons, page 175. Some people say, why do we need to suffer? I mean, why so much pain? Why, when I pray to God, doesn't God answer my prayers? Well, let me tell you something, folks. When we pray and ask God for something, God answers in one of three ways. He answers yes, or he answers no, or he answers wait. And the problem is we take wait as a no answer. But God knows when it's best for him to wait, because we learn to trust in him. That's the reason why he allows God's people to go through the tribulation in the end time, to reveal to the world that even though the worst may come to them, they lose everything, the adversary takes everything they have, God is going to prove to the universe that he has a group of people who are absolutely loyal to him, though the heavens fall. And the challenges of the devil against God are going to be answered once and for all. There will be a whole generation of saints who will be faithful to God in the worst circumstances, even willing to face death if necessary. Christ's Object Lessons 175. The Lord permits trials in order that we may be cleansed from earthliness, from selfishness, from harsh, unchristlike traits of character. Let me ask you, when gold is tried in the fire or refined in the fire, what do they throw in the fire? Only gold? No, there's all kinds of, there's stones and there's dirt. What happens with all the dirt and the stones and everything? They're all burned up. And what comes out on the other side? Pure gold. So she says, the Lord permits trials in order that we may be cleansed from earthliness, from selfishness, from harsh, unchristlike traits of character. He suffers the deep waters of affliction to go over our souls in order that we may know him and Jesus Christ whom he has sent, in order that we may have deep heart longings to be cleansed from defilement and may come forth from the trial purer, holier, happier. Often we enter the furnace of trial with our souls darkened with selfishness. But if patient, notice the key word, but if patient, under the crucial test, we shall come forth reflecting the divine character. So is suffering a blessing? Will the delay during the time of trouble be a blessing for God's people? It most certainly will be. But do we need to withstand delays today in smaller things in our lives? Yes, this is rehearsal, folks. Let's not get aggravated over our little trials and tribulations. You know, we might lose a job and we might have some family strife and we might have lost some money in the stock market or whatever. You know, let's not get bent out of shape over all of that. Let's trust in God. Let's continue coming to him in times of relative prosperity, because the time is coming when we will have to come to him in times of severe crisis and adversity. So once again, I ask the question. When Jesus ended the parable, he finished with the question. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith in the earth? In other words, will he find this kind of faith? The faith that is illustrated by the widow, by Jacob, by Job, by the three young men in the furnace, by the Canaanite woman, by Jesus, who kept on coming and coming. Jesus says, when the Son of Man comes, will he find this kind of faith and patience, perseverance on the earth? Unfortunately, the parable ends with the question. And you wonder, as you read the parable, whether this question is answered yes or no. Is God going to have a group on the earth that will have the kind of faith that this widow had? Well, I praise the Lord that the answer is not found in Luke chapter 18, but it is found in Revelation. The two verses that we began our study with today, Revelation chapter 13 and verse 10. Revelation chapter 13 and verse 10. Is God going to have a people who have this characteristic? Absolutely. It says there, he who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. Is God going to have a group who have the faith and patience of the saints in the midst of the trial? Absolutely. And as we read at the conclusion of the third angel's message, immediately after God has spoken about the beast, his image, his mark, the number of his name, we find this declaration. There is going to be a group who will have this kind of faith. It says there in Revelation 14, verse 12, here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. So what is the answer to the question that Jesus asked in his parable? Will he find faith? Will he find the patience of the saints on the earth? The answer in the book of Revelation is a resounding yes. And the question is, will we be among those who have the patience of the saints?